Well, hello you bearded bastards, and welcome back once again to Stetargusgash, Honeystoker, where time is continuing its forward march, at a brisk pace, mind you. Right now it is the 12th of Felsite 288, late spring, the start of yet another year, and where things have been seemingly going a bit downhill since 285, I'd say that this year looks a little brighter, in certain aspects anyways. I'll show you what I mean. A little fortress rundown, if you will. Now, the traders still have not returned, which is a very worrying thing, and so we're not going to be able to rely on them for food anymore. It's just not safe, and so we still regularly have to send dwarves up to the surface to collect brewable plants. It's a bit annoying, but we're making do. The dwarves don't seem to mind that much anyways, most of whom are doing fairly well still. Most of whom. We do have a couple like Burr the mechanic over here, a fairly recent arrival. Or Tun the Butcher right here, another miserable bastard. And then of course Mathfall, our chief medical dwarf, who is now described as being utterly harrowed by the nightmare that is her life. Mentally, she's the worst of the worst right now, and I'm not sure how much longer she's got, honestly. Now, her husband, Id, one of our mechanics, and also one of our sponsored dwarves, who remember are partially controlled by people outside of the game, well, he doesn't want her thrown out of the fortress, no matter what. Which is understandable, sure, but I have a distinct feeling that's not going to work out too well. But we're trying our best. It should also be mentioned that Id here has kind of become our expedition leader, just because Atir is nowhere to be found. He's doing a pretty decent job at it too. He seems to be well suited for the task. I'm just hoping he can keep a good head on his shoulders if something happens to his wife, but I guess time will tell. Back to the whole Atir Iron Tongue situation, our leaders. Well, a few months back, oh dear. Well, that's something right there. Okay, well, Mathfall, our chief medical dwarf, is here at the entrance of our fortress, just laying on the ground being terribly depressed. Not yet insane though, mind you. Well, she just sighted something entering the fortress. Something dark and terrible, something we haven't seen in a while. A werehorse. The werehorse Nakoslazungokang. Its eyes glow violet and its hair is charcoal. Identical to that one that killed a couple dwarves a few years back. Well, I'm not sure she stands much of a chance at this point, honestly. Certainly not in her current state, but there is no way she can outrun that thing. But, see, I hate when this happens, because what do? Not much. I mean, she was on her way out in the first place, I guess. And this'll just be a blaze of glory, I suppose. We can't do anything, our hands are tied. Dwarves, let's go to the meeting hall. Come on, everyone. And I'm also going to pull this lever here and try to close up the fortress gate. The gate that's closer to the fortress, not the far one. I don't want to crush Mathfall on accident. And I'm also going to select Mathfall specifically to go attack that werehorse. Alright, the order is given. Alright, Mathfall, let's do this. Blaze of glory. And we're going to be taking this one step at a time, just like we did with that last attack. Alright, Mathfall's moving up. She's engaged, the werehorse is fighting. Dodging. In the air, falling back down the ramp, fighting, is grappling with a werehorse. They're at the bottom now. She's dancing around the creature. She's currently fighting wonderfully. The horse has not hit her once, and she's got several good strikes in. Still fighting. Keep it up, Mathfall. Ooh, I think she just took a hit. Yes, the horse kicked her in her hand, but she is still going. Absolutely fine. There you go, Mathfall, that's how you do it. She's backed up against a wall, dodging so well. Ooh, and she just broke the thing's leg with her hammer. That's amazing. It's on the ground now, it cannot stand up with its broken leg. Ho-ho! It looks like the werehorse just turned back into a goblin, who is trying to run away, and is apparently bleeding all over the place. Ooh, that thing is it's a bit quick. Right, I believe it got fully healed when it turned back into a goblin. That blood must be from when it ran through that pool of blood that was on the ground. Alright, I tell you what, we're gonna speed things up a little bit. There we go, Mathfall chasing the goblin down into the Tower of Memories. And I believe she killed the goblin on the stairway. And she most certainly did. Killed with a silver warhammer to the head. Ho ho ho, fantastic work, Mathfall. One beautiful dwarf. Although that still does leave us with a problem. I was kinda hoping she'd go out in a blaze of glory. But she is still depressed. And now we have a hero dwarf who's going to die shortly. I believe, anyways. Oh man, she really screwed up that goblin, too. Big time. disconcerting, the werehorse bites the chief medical dwarf in the right upper arm, tearing apart the fat through the cave spider silk cloak. That was the one hit the creature was able to get in on Mathal, besides kicking her in the hand. Oh boy, bit by a werehorse. That is not great. Well, that is an interesting turn. Well, we're gonna pause the game for now, just while I explain some things. Now remember, at the end of last year, we were passing notes back and forth underneath this door right here, and communicating with our leaders that way. And we have been following all of their commands, to the best of our ability anyways. But you may remember that the last letter we received last year said that we were to lock the dwarves up in the meeting hall on the 28th of Timber. So we did. And on the 29th, when the dwarves went to go check the room, the door was opened. But there were no sign of Atir or Iron Tongue. They were gone. But now we no longer have access into the Tower of Memories. As I had suspected, those modifications we were asked to complete were done in order to make the place a living space for them. So now, up in the high tower that overlooks our tiny fortress, there is, I assume, a trio of vampires. Atir, Iron Tongue, and Serol, the one who killed those three dwarves. It is an interesting turn, but it doesn't really change much for us fortress dwarves. Not in any great way, mind you. Now we've been passing notes back and forth through these doors up here in the tower. It's still the same situation. They give us commands, which we carry out, and we ask questions, most of which they answer. They have at this point confirmed that the three of them are in the tower, and that all three of them are, in fact, vampires. Atir and Iron Tongue included, which of course has the dwarves a bit on edge. But they're still offering very useful advice to us dwarves, and are always wishing us well. And so I guess we're just gonna keep following orders for now, while asking questions from time to time. The latest of which being what we should do with Mathal, our potential werehorse. She probably became infected in that attack, and now it's completely unsafe to have her running around. And although we're asking, I have a distinct feeling I already know the answer of what they're gonna want done with her. For you see, a few months ago, we also tangled briefly with a werehorse. Luckily, the thing didn't cause much harm. We spotted it as it entered through the main gate right here, which sounds terrible. But upon spotting the thing, we got the dwarves down to the meeting hall, while it ran around killing some of our stray animals that were wandering around, which was pretty much it. And it just ended up doing that for a while, running around like an idiot, until it turned back into a human. Of course, at that point, we had the gates locked up, and so it couldn't leave the fortress, and started running around in a panic. It ran around the main area here for a little bit, came up here and ran around in the second tier for a while, and then we eventually got it trapped in our stock room. And in a panic, we had to ask the vampires what to do. And so they had us lock it up in there, by building a wall in front of these doors. And while it was locked up safely in the stock room here, we also received some directions. A floor plan of sorts, which you can see right over this way. And we of course have been following it to the best of our ability. Now we do have that human locked up in a cage, and it's just placed in the middle here. Now while I'm not entirely sure of the purpose of this oddly shaped prison, the vampires have dubbed this an experimental infection chamber, and so I have a pretty good idea what it's intended to be used for. What are we doing here, dwarves? Oh, Honeystoker, what direction are you headed? Well, anyways, I have to imagine those vampires are going to want her placed in here if they think she's another werehorse. But we'll ask them just to be sure. And for now, Mathal, we're going to have to send you down to the mines. Now, this is going to seem a bit cruel, but we have to lock her down here for now. Just so we can be 100% sure that she is a werehorse. And if she is, then well, we'll have to see what the vampires want to do with her. And if she's not, then I guess we'll see what happens. Either way, I don't foresee a good outcome for poor Mathal here. Anyways, while we're still on the subject of werehorses, if you look down over this way, we could see a capybara corpse, just kind of sitting out here at the edge of these trees. Now, I had forgot to mention it, but last year, I had seen these capybaras fighting. We never actually saw a werehorse, but if we have a look at the report here, we could see that that is actually what killed them. And that actually wasn't that long ago either. Maybe 6 months or so. So I have the distinct feeling that werehorses are all over the place in this world. It certainly does seem that way anyways. With that in mind, it's beyond me why the hell the vampires would want more of them, but I suppose we're just following orders at this point. Oh, Honeystoker. Well, back here in the fortress, we just received word from the vampires as usual, with a response as to what we should do with Mathal. and it's a bit surprising, really. Well, the first thing they want us to do is wait to see if she's actually a werehorse, which makes sense. And if she is, they do not want her placed in this prison with the other werehorse. According to them, that would be cruel, and they say they would never want something like that. Certainly not for Mafal, one of our kin. They have instead insisted that we make a special bedroom for Id, her husband, with another room for Mafal, connected by a fortification, through which they can see each other, and that way they could be together. Which is a shockingly compassionate plan, and one that the dwarves readily agree with. Ugh, none of this makes any sense. Vampires are supposed to be cruel, heartless, blood-sucking monsters, right? Well, I suppose if our fortress is going to be run by a couple of vampires, then I'm very pleased that our blood-sucking monsters have some compassion. Back down here in the mines, we're still waiting to see if Mafal in fact does turn into a werehorse on the full moon. Right now it is the 15th of Hematite, and the full moon is on the 19th, I believe. Let's watch. The days are passing, slowly, as Mafal sits down here, in her stony prison, depressed and dejected, and wondering what the full moon will bring. Oh, there she goes. It is now confirmed, Mafal, our chief medical dwarf, is a werehorse. Okay, dwarves, it's time to get started on that structure, which we will get to right away. The note has suggested taking Atir's old room, since she's not going to be using it anymore. And so that's exactly what we're going to be doing. It's right down here, there's a couple of rooms. And that's how we'll do it right there. It's going to be nice and spacious because we can't put furniture in there, which is what I would normally do to niceen a place up a bit, but we have to think of something that she's not going to destroy every full moon. And so I think it might be best if we put down some copper floors and possibly walls as well. On top of that, we could do some engravings. That might be cool. And then up this way here, I was thinking of trying out a bath. And we're going to fill up this pit kind of shallow with water. I don't know if that'll work or if she'd even appreciate it, but yeah, it's worth a try, right? The dwarves are going to get started right away. Now, while we get Mafal's new room set up, we do have some other things to attend to. For one, it has been 3 years now since we opened our doors and now allow new migrants to the fortress. And our population is only 33 dwarves, which is, frankly, very pitiful. We've gotten the notification a few times that no migrants have arrived to the fortress this season. Just season after season after season. We did get a couple migrant waves, but they weren't very big. But the vampires actually gave us a very good idea recently. And they suggested that we head over to the surrounding hillocks. Remember that we had a few pop up recently, like Wave Razors over here to the west, Blood Mirrored, Theater Held, there's a whole bunch of them, each with its own small population, and we can actually assign a messenger to go to these hillocks and request workers that will then come live in our fortress, which sounds like just a fantastic idea. And so I think we're gonna start doing that. Anything to help boost our dwindling population. It's really quite sad. And as for a messenger, well, I was thinking that Zuthan Avuzalis would make a great choice, actually. She is the fortress's only beekeeper, and she's been with us for quite some time, but I don't know, just something about her. I feel like she'd be a great choice. And so, Zuthan, you are our new messenger. Do us proud. And your first mission, Zuthan, will be to... How about Fainted Gravel, up here to the north? It is a bit close to goblin territory, but there are 100 dwarves that live here. Alright, well, we have a few choices, with all sorts of skills. Not too sure why it is exactly, but we can only select a few dwarves. I guess they're probably the only ones who would want to come to our fortress. Well, that'll do, I think. We'll select these 6, and we will assign Zuthan. And she's off. Good luck, Zuthan. She should be back in a couple days. I don't imagine it'll take very long. Oh, and it looks like an artifact was just created down in the mines, by Tassid Zolisinol, one of the dwarves we met last episode. Tassid, the smith, and former leather worker, has created Nomao Zokal, a short wild boar leather skirt. He claims it as a family heirloom. Very interesting. Let's have a look. The Staff of Covens, and it is not worth very much. This is a short wild boar leather skirt. All craftsmanship is of the highest quality. It is decorated with wild boar leather and encircled with bands of wild boar leather. This object menaces with spikes of wild boar leather. On the item is an image of the Basin of Tarnish, the steel battle axe, in brown jasper, as well as an image of Nekkar Lyric tributes the human in apricot wood. The human is withering away, which relates to the passing of Nekkar in the barricaded murk in the mid-spring of 276. Interesting. Just for the heck of it real quick, I took a look behind the scenes here to see who this Nekkar character was. And it looks like he's the founder and leader of a human bandit gang that was formed in 223. in which he led until the year 276, in which he died of old age. As far as I know, that gang is still out there somewhere in the swamp, the same swamp in which our fortress is located, but I'm sure they won't be giving us any trouble. Just an interesting side note here. I'm not too sure why there'd be an image of him on here, but it's interesting nonetheless. And overall, I'd say this is a fairly interesting artifact as well. Good job, Tossid. I think this will pair nicely with that Yeti leather armor we had made last episode, actually. Interesting. I'll have to keep that in mind. Oh, would you look at that? It looks like Zuthan has returned, with some new faces, and some animals as well. Just a couple. Interesting. Whoa, fantastic. Some merchants. A little side note here. There's currently a bug in the game that makes these merchant units, useless. Like, they won't perform any tasks whatsoever, but they will still gladly eat your food and drink your drinks. So that makes them more than a little troublesome. Well, good job, Zuthan. I'm not too sure what we're going to do with these slackabouts, but we'll find something in time, I'm sure. I hope. We'll see. Go figure. We just received the notification again that the fortress attracted no migrants this season. I'm not too sure why that would be, other than the rumor that our fortress is being controlled by a group of vampires, that is. Yeah, I guess that would do it. And so that being the case, I suppose we'll send Zuthan straight back out, and hopefully we can get some dwarves that aren't merchants. How about over here? Wave raisers. And there's only 3 dwarves we could choose, and I guess we'll take them all. You have your order, Zuthan. And remember, if they look like they're merchants, then you really don't have to worry about them. Good luck. Now back over here to Mathal's room, you can see it's pretty much done. It's all dug out and we do have some engravings carved onto the walls now. And you can see on the floor there, those are silver bars. We actually didn't have much copper to spare, so I didn't use it, but silver's better, I imagine. So there we go. The last thing we have to do is get her bath in place, filled up with water and such, and then we just have to get her in here and seal it up, which might be a bit dicey, but we'll see what happens. And down here it looks like Zuthan has arrived once more, with the new dwarves. A single dwarf, that is. A merchant, too. Fantastic. Okay, well, getting new dwarves this way seems a little fruitless, kind of a damn shame, but again, I'm sure we'll eventually find something to do with these guys. Taking a look at the calendar here, it is the 6th of Limestone, 288, early autumn, and so we know what that means, dwarves. It is time for the autumn festival once more, and well, I mean, we were kind of in the middle of getting Mathal's room ready here, and she is still down here in the mines. There's no way we can enjoy an autumn festival with her down here like this, and plus poor Id, her husband. I can't imagine he'd want that either. It is the 6th of Limestone right now, and the full moon is on the 13th, and I'm pretty sure we can get her into a room by then absolutely fine. Pretty sure. Let's see if we can do that. Alright, so I took Mathal and I put her in her own squad, and I'm going to order that squad to move down here to this room. And I'm also having a dwarf come over here and mine out this tiny section of stone, just so she can get out of the mines, you know. Come on, hurry up, dwarves. There we go, okay, she's free. And heading up, it is the 8th of Limestone right now, we still have a couple days, and now we're following Mathal. Hopefully she heads to our room, although it looks like she's picking up equipment right now. Alright, now she's going. And down in her room, I'm trying to get a couple of these buckets out of here. That'd be nice. Although not very important. In fact, I guess I am being a little careless. But there is just one more in there. Come on. Somebody get it, please? It's probably fine. Alright, we'll leave it. Now we just have to get somebody down here to build this fortification really quick. It's the 11th of Limestone right now. We have 2 days. It's not looking great. Oh, there we go. Okay. Perfect. Fantastic. Done deal. And Mathal, we can now disband her squad, and let her check out her new digs, I suppose. And she just turned into a werehorse. Man, that was some foolish timing on my part. That could have been real bad. Well, we got lucky. And I guess now we'll try to enjoy the Autumn Festival, even though it's going to be a bit strange without Mathal here. Alright, dwarves, welcome to the Autumn Festival of 288, which actually marks the 10th year since we started doing these festivals. That's exciting. It's pretty crazy how fast time passes here, especially lately. With so many projects going on, the tower, the werehorse prison, Mathal's new room, it's really all just been a flurry of activity, but we're all still, somehow, in fairly high spirits. Doesn't really make any sense. I mean, when you consider that we're being led by a group of vampires, we have werehorses dwelling in our fortress, and we also have no idea in what direction our fortress is headed right now. But I guess we're just going with the flow. Things are going well now, so drink, eat, and be merry, dwarves. And try not to worry too much about all the terrible events that are clustered around us. As best you can, anyways. Although, it is difficult to not worry about our leaders and their motives. What's the goal? And why do they seem so benevolent? Is it all a trick? I suppose it could well be, with them being blood-sucking monsters and all. And why wear horses? That seems a bit more than careless. Again, we're just simple dwarves here in Stetargusgash, and it's all most likely beyond our understanding. And so for now, I suppose we'll just keep following orders and trying to live our lives as best we can. We just gotta hope it all works itself out in the end. Come, dwarves, come, for the time is now. It is a sad thing that we can no longer dwell with our brethren, but this is our home now, the Tower of Memories. But this is no prison in which we will languish away till the end of days. No, this is only the start of something new, something better, something much, much bigger. And so, my dwarves, let's break down this wall and see what this new life has to offer. Fantastic. And now we have access to the caverns. Very, very exciting. And a glorious thing they are, too. Formed of sparkling quartzite, and dotted with clusters of gems. Milk quartz, zircon, and even some blue garnet up above. Just astounding. But for all its beauty, we must also be wary of the dangers that lurk here. The caverns are a deadly place, filled with twisting turns, deadly rock falls, and the most dangerous of all, the beasts, of which there are many. But we would also do well to remember that we are no ordinary dwarves. Not anymore, that is. The other races would call us vampire, but in our tongue, we are called the Nazusheb, bloodsuckers. In this current form, we are hated and feared by many, but they know not the benefits of our gift. Benefits which will be used to aid our people, the embattled dwarves. Something made possible only with the help of Mosus, the wild boar man. It seems there was more to that pigman than we could have ever thought. But now we know. And with our new knowledge and our power, we will bring glory to all of dwarvenkind and to the Nazusheb. We are the darkness that will bring forth the light. Yes, the vampires have been very busy down here in the Tower of Memories, or more specifically, the caverns beneath the Tower of Memories, and I think the time has come to do a quick overview of what they've been working on. Finally, we get to pull back the veil a little bit. Now then. Now this chamber here leads up to the tower itself, through this narrow stairwell, that goes up quite a distance. To this level right here, where the dwarves do have access to lignite, which they can use as fuel, and the path continues up this way here, where there's another stairwell that leads directly to this mining shaft, which then leads up to the tower's top, right here. Now remember, we do have this other shaft over this way here, covered up with this hatch, and this shaft here leads down to the fortress level. Now, the purpose of that is so that the vampires down here can create goods. Cloth, weapons, that sort of stuff, that they can then throw down to our dwarves. I don't know how well it's going to work, but, well, I guess we'll see shortly, huh? Now, you will notice that this entryway here out into the caverns is protected by a couple of doors made of quartzite, as well as a stone bridge, controlled by this lever over here, just in case anything nasty pops up, which I'm sure will happen before long. And as for these caverns out here, you'll notice they are a bit barren. No moss or mushrooms or anything like that, and there's not even any water whatsoever. But there are a bunch of gems and silk webs, which we've been turning into cloth, but right up this way here to the north, you can see we have a downward passage that leads down to this level here, which you can see is filled with water. But there's also quite a few large mushrooms that we could use for wood, and even some small patches of fungus and moss, which will come in handy as well. Although I don't think we'll be going down this far quite yet. Now these vampires down here, or the Nazusheb, as they prefer to be called, they've had to face some harsh realities in these past couple of years, ever since Mosus last showed up. The scraped chambers, our civilization, is scattered and dying. The armies of Gugo Uzburial, the demon king, march across this land in greater numbers than ever before, and soon they will overcome us. If they haven't already, that is. Visits from the dwarven caravans have been dwindling, and we never even see the humans anymore, and so news from the outside world has been sparse, but that fact in itself tells a dire tale. These were facts that were shown to the vampires after they drank from Mosus' cup during his last visit. True, he did trick us. We did not willingly choose to be Nazusheb, but now, with the wheels set into motion, we wouldn't have it any other way. Because this, unfortunately, looks like it's going to be our only way to survive in this world. Now, if you don't already know, vampires receive an enormous boost to strength, and speed for that matter, making them much more powerful combatants. On top of that fact, they no longer have to sleep, eat, or even drink. Yes, in Fortress Mode here, vampires do not have to drink blood. They will of course still do it if they have access to sleeping individuals, which these ones do not, thankfully. And so with that being the case, we can maximize the fighting potential of our small population. I'm thinking a squad of 10 dwarven vampires can do quite the amount of damage to the goblins. Just imagine that, wouldn't that be something? Of course, that was one of Mosus' suggestions, and in fact it seems to be his one driving purpose. He wants to see the goblins crushed, and for the dwarves to succeed, and he has also thankfully opened our eyes to our civilization's deficits. And that's also part of the reason why we decided to keep our hands on this werehorse here. It's a powerful creature, with a very unique gift. I'm not sure if it's one that will benefit us, and I'm certainly not guaranteeing that this infection chamber will actually work. But if we can use it, then what the hell? You know what they say. Never look a gift horse in the mouth. It's just that our one major problem right now is getting more vampires. We only have 3 right now, and optimally, all the dwarves in the fortress would eventually become Nazusheb. If only that damn well had worked. Of course, we're not blaming Mosus. It was only a theoretical plan. Plus, he had given us some new ideas on how to improve it, ideas that we had handed over to the dwarves already, and I imagine they should soon be getting them underway. Or they're supposed to anyways, after this year's Autumn Festival. I'm just really hoping they don't get too shocked when they end up going through with it. But they have been following our plans diligently so far, so hopes are high. And on top of that, soon we will be expanding the Tower of Memories, by quite a bit, I'm hoping. All of the dwarves in the fortress will eventually become vampires, and we have to be sure there's enough room for them in the tower when... What was that? From the caverns! Something approaches. Something huge. Beneath the surface of the lands of Blazing, there lurk great, titanic creatures of untold age. Huge in form, and with appetites to match. They were created long ago, before the beginning of time. They lurk there still, ranging far and wide in the endless tunnels beneath our very feet. The forgotten beast Letha Pinyosata has come. A huge thrush with external ribs. It has 2 long, curving horns and it has a bloated body. Its clear feathers are patchy. Beware its deadly spittle. We hear it now, its pained cries echoing through the tunnels. We are intruders here, in its home, and it seeks to push us back upwards, to the surface. But we are not going without a fight. To arms, Nazusheb! Our first great challenge has arrived. And if we are to maintain our foothold here in these caverns, this beast must be pushed back. Prepare yourselves. For Stetargusgash, for Mosus, for the dwarves. Well, you bearded bastards. You know, in the past I've mentioned that I don't enjoy leaving off on cliffhangers, but you know what? I guess sometimes I do. I'm terribly sorry. Well, anyways, I hope you enjoyed watching this episode, and I certainly hope you'll join me next time, so we can see the outcome to this first great battle for the Nazusheb. Will they be successful, or will the boar man's plans fail here? We will find out soon enough. And until then, you bearded bastards,